Hello boys, I'm Pushkar, your social science teacher. Today we will start our past ones, chapter 11. Chapter name is New Empires and Kingdoms. What is empire? Empire is a group of countries, states or regions ruled by monarch, an oligarchy or a sovereign state. And second is kingdom is a country, state or territory ruled by a king or queen. In this chapter, a boy, Arvin had been chosen to act as a king in the school play. He had expected to march solemnly in splendid robes, to twirl his mustaches and wield the silver paper wrapped swords with gusto. Just imagine, he surprised when he was told he would also have to sit and play a veena and recite poetry. A musician king, he thought. Who was that? He wondered. Prashasti, what they tell us. Arvind was supposed to be acting as a Samudragupta. Samudragupta was a famous ruler of dynasty known as the Guptas. We know about the Samudragupta from long inscriptions, actually a poem in Sanskrit, which is composed by his court poet Harishena nearly 1700 years ago. This was inscribed on the Ashokan pillar at Allahabad. Allahabad is the city in Uttar Pradesh state of India, but this name has changed. It's now is Prayagraj. This inscription is of a special kind known as Prashasti. It's a Sanskrit word meaning in praise of. While Prashastis were composed for someone of the rulers, you read about in chapter 10, like Gautamiputra Sri Satkarni, they become far more important from the time of the Guptas. So I think you got to know about the Prashasti. Prashasti is that to say something about a famous person. As I told you just about the Samudragupta, Harishena has written a poem. That poem is called the Prashasti, in praise of. Now we'll talk about Samudragupta's Prashasti. Samudragupta Prashasti basically tells us about the king. The poet praised the king in glory terms, like as a warrior, as a king who won victories in battle, who has learned and the best of poets. Prashasti was composed in very long sentences. Here's a part of one such sentence. Samudragupta, the warrior, whose body was most charming, being covered with plenteous beauty of the marks of hundreds of scars caused by battle axes, arrows, spikes, spears, barbed darts, swords, iron clubs, javelins, barbed arrows, long arrows and many other weapons. If you look at map 7 in your book, you will notice an area shaded in green. You will also find a series of red dots along east coast, and you will find areas marked in purple and blue as well. This map is based on the information provided in Prashasti. Harishena describes 4 different kinds of rulers and tell us about Samudragupta's policies towards them. Number 1 policy was the rulers of Aryavrata. The area shaded in green on the map here were 9 rulers who were uprooted, and their kingdoms were made of part of Samudragupta's empire. Number two, the rulers of Dakshinapath. Here, there were 12 rulers, some of whose capitals are marked with red dots on the map. This surrendered to Samudragupta after being defeated, and he then allowed them to rule again. Number third policy, the inner circle of neighboring states, including Assam, coastal Bengal, Nepal, and number of Garasangs in the northwest marked in purple on the map. They brought tribute, followed his orders, and attended his court. The ruler of outlying areas marked in blue on the map, perhaps the descendants of the Kushnas and Shakas, and the ruler of Sri Lanka also submitted to him and offered daughters in the marriages. If we talk about the genealogies, most Prashastis also mention the ancestors of the ruler. Samudragupta's great grandfather, grandfather, father, and mother. His mother's name was Kumara Devi. She belonged to the Lichavi Gana, while his father Chandragupta was first ruler of the Gupta dynasty to adopt the grand title of Maharajadhiraj. Samudragupta also used that title in his era. Samudragupta in turn figures in the genealogies of the later rulers of the dynasty, such as his son Chandragupta II. We know about him from inscriptions and coins. According to later belief, his court was full of learned people, including Kalidas the poet, the Aryabhatta the astronomer, about whom you will read more in chapter 12. Now the next is Harshvardhana and Harshcharita. Basically, Harshvardhan, he was the ruler in Harshvardhana and Harshcharita. I explain you again. Harshvardhana and the Harshcharita, we can learn about the Gupta's rulers or their inscriptions and coins, and we can find out about some kings from biographies. Harshvardhana, who ruled nearly 1400 years ago, was one such ruler. His court poet Banbhatt wrote his biography. The biography name was Harshcharita in Sanskrit. It gives the genealogy of Harsha and ends with his becoming king Xuanzang, about whom you read in chapter 10. Also spent a lot of time in Harsha's court and left the detailed account of what he saw in his court. Harsha was not the eldest son of his father, but became king of Thanesar after both his father and elder brother died. His brother-in-law was the ruler of Kannauj. And was killed by the ruler of Bengal. Harsha took over kingdom of Kannauj and then led an army against the ruler of Bengal. And he conquered both Magadha and Bengal. He was not as successful elsewhere. He tried to cross the Narmada to march into the Deccan, but was stopped by a ruler belonging to the Chalukya dynasty, Pulakeshin II. Now we will understand about the Pallavas, Chalukyas, and Pulakeshins, Prashasti. In this, the Pallavas and Chalukyas were the most important ruling dynasties in South India during this period. The kingdom of the Pallavas spread from the region Kanchipuram to the Kaveri Delta. The Chalukyas were centered around the Raichur Doab between the rivers Krishna and Tungabhadra. Ahole, the capital of Chalukyas, was an important trading center. The Pallavas and Chalukyas frequently raided another's land. The best known Chalukyas rulers was Pulakeshin II. We know about him from a prashasti composed by his court poet Ravi Kirti. Pulakeshin evidently got the kingdom from his uncle. Pulakeshin also attacked the Pallava king, who took shelter behind the walls of Kanchipuram. But the Chalukya victory was short-lived. Ultimately, both Pallavas and the Chalukyas gave way to new rulers belonging to the Rashtrakuta and Chola dynasties. Now, how were these kingdoms administered? In this case, the earlier kings, land revenue remained important for these rulers, and the village remained the basic unit of administration. For instance, some important administrative posts were now hereditary. This means that sons succeeded fathers to these posts. For example, the poet Harishena was Mahadandanayak, or chief judicial officer, like his father. Sometimes one person had many offices. For instance, besides being a Mahadandanayak, Harishena was a Kumar Amatya, meaning an important minister, and a Sandhi Vigrahika, meaning a minister of war and peace. Men probably had a say in local administration, included the Nagarshreshti, or chief banker or merchant of the city, the Sartahava, or leader of the merchant caravans, the Prathma Kalika, or the chief craftsmen, and the head of the Kayasthas, or scribes. Now we will talk about the new kind of army. Like earlier rulers, some of these kings maintained a well-organized army with elephants, chariots, cavalry, and foot soldiers. There were military leaders who provided the king with troops whenever he needed them. They were not paid regular salaries. Instead, some of them received grants of land. They collected revenue from the land and used this to maintain soldiers and horses and provide equipment for warfare. These men were known as Samantas. And inscriptions of the Pallavas mention a number. We are talking about assemblies in the southern kingdoms. The inscriptions of the Pallavas mention a number of local assemblies. These included the Sabha, which was an assembly of Brahmin landowners. The Ur was a village assembly found in areas where the landowners were not Brahmins. And the Nagaram was an organization of merchants. Basically, Nagaram. It is likely that these assemblies were controlled by rich and powerful landowners and merchants. If we talk about ordinary people in the kingdom, Kalidasa is known for his plays depicting life in the king's court. An interesting feature about these plays is that the king and most Brahmins are shown as speaking Sanskrit, while women and men other than the king and Brahmins use Prakrit language. So we are just we are just finished this end of the chapter. You can read about, if you are interested, a fisherman finds a ring and the king's army. The article is there. If you will read, will be good. And we will start a next chapter in our next week. Okay, so just read this chapter again, and I will give you the exercises in our next class also. Okay, so do it and finish your reading. Okay, if you have any problem, any doubt, you may text me. Thank you, boys. See you.